experimental superconducting circuit with Irfan Siddiqui, and I will be the introducer. Today, I would like to maybe motivate why we need to be able to simulate quantum circuits, and why is it important. So the first reason why it's important, it allows us to benchmark our quantum processor. And an example of this is randomized benchmarking. So because because the circuits that we use for randomized benchmarking are classically computable, we are able to predict the outcome of the quantum circuit and thus assess the performance of a quantum processor. So this is why one reason why it's important. A second reason is quantum supremacy claim. So this is a figure I have taken from the quantum supremacy paper by Google from 2019. And the argument is that for certain circuits, when you come to a deep enough circuit and enough qubit, you will not be able to simulate the circuit classically. And this is what they indicate in those number here. They indicate how much time it will take if you were to simulate the circuit. And basically at some point it becomes so prohibitively long that you say that you are in the quantum supremacy regime, because classically you cannot do it. So this is also one reason why it's important to push simulation of quantum circuit. And finally, the last reason is also to develop new algorithm and validate them. So right now, there are not so many quantum computers. And also, they are very noisy. So if you want to develop a new idea or a new algorithm, it's going to be very hard. You will have to first get access to the quantum computer and then deal with all the error. So having a proper simulation tools allow to develop much faster those new algorithm. Okay, so in the spirit of a tutorial, I will try to go through the basics. So and try to explain what is a quantum circuit. So a quantum circuit is something represented diagrammatically like this, right? The time goes from left to right, and we know that by applying a succession of gate, we can prepare any state that we want. So here we know that this represents the Hadamard gate on a single qubit, and this is a CNOT gate. And what we expect out of simulating such a circuit is or something close to the experiment, which will be the outcome distribution, a probability distribution for each bit string at the end. Or we can also maybe try to simulate the state vector or the density matrix, which will have the full information about the state at the end of the computation. We can also do this experimentally, but not just, we require more circuit and we need to do tomography. So how do we calculate, how do we simulate the circuit? So the naive approach, or Schrodinger approach, is to just say, this is just a matrix multiplication, and I just, for every step inside this circuit, I will calculate the full state vector. So here, to calculate the first intermediary state, I will just multiply the initial state with the Hadamard gate on one qubit Kronecker identity, and I get the superposition of 0 and 1 on the first qubit. And now, if I just apply the second gate to this intermediary state, I get the Bell pair as expected. So this is one way of interpreting the circuit, where you need to know the state vector at every step of the circuit. So this, you need to be able to store the state vector. So it's a 2^n, where n is the number of qubit size array of complex number. And you also need to be able to construct this operation matrix. So you can be more or less smart about it, but you still need to construct every unitary at every step. There is another approach, which is more linked to Feynman path approach and tensor network. And so the idea is that with the same circuit, now instead of calculating the full state. What I will do is what you do is that you sum over all the possible intermediate state, and here I have only one intermediate state, and this allows us, for instance, to calculate the overlap between the final state and 0, 0. And here I'm just summing over all the possibility with this intermediary state here between being 0 and 1. Here, basically, you are constructing a tensor representation, and this is, for instance, the table that you obtain through this. And to obtain the state, you just need to sum all those paths in order to get the outcome of the circuit. So why is this interesting is that there's been a lot of tool developed for a tensor network, a very efficient tool, and it's actually sometimes much better than the naive approach that I showed just before. And Yipeng will talk a lot more about that. So now I would like to just discuss this. I took this picture from the supplement of the quantum supremacy paper from Google in 2019, where they show the computational cost for with each type of algorithm on specific circuits. So here on the left, you have the computational cost with the matrix multiplication. And you see that if you have a low number of qubits, you should be able, like if you don't have too many qubits, you should be able to simulate your circuit without too much issue. But as you increase the number of qubits, it starts to be harder. And the number of files, it's almost constant, but it's still a bit harder every time. And here you see that with the Feynman algorithm and Thompson network, now you have access to a range of circuits which have a low depth, but much more a qubit. So what this shows is that basically, if you have a lot of qubits, but you cannot do many cycles, you will not be in some supremacy, quantum supremacy regime or quantum advantage regime. And this is what they try to show, is that you want to be really in this regime where the time for classical computation become prohibitively large. And so here they show like the difference between some circuits that they can actually calculate, and here circuit that they cannot calculate, and they claim that the circuits that they have are in the supremacy regime. So I think this was kind of interesting because like recently there has been a manuscript on the archive by Peng and others, where they say that no, they are able to simulate the supremacy circuits that were used in this paper. They were able to simulate it with only 15 hours. And if they had access to one of the best supercomputers, they will be able to simulate it in a few dozen of seconds, or something which is faster than actually running the circuit in on the quantum hardware. And I think this is very important, because this actually says that quantum supremacy, like the boundary of what we call quantum supremacy, is really moving as what we know about simulating the circuit evolve as well. Okay, so now one thing that is also very important is trying to have noise. Like we know that we are in an era where quantum computers are noisy. And this has been termed noisy intermediate state quantum era. And we know that we have different noise on our qubit, on our algorithm. And I can tell you that experimentally, like most of the work is to characterize the source of those noise and try to mitigate them. So you have, of course, the decoherence of the qubit itself. So T1 decay, dephasing E decay, which are illustrated here on the block sphere. But you have also like more pernicious error. You can have small calibration error on your pulses, which will lead to just like your unitary is not exactly doing what you want. And you also have crosstalk error, where when you try to apply an operation on one gate, you also do a small operation. Sorry, when you apply a gate on one qubit, you will also do a small operation on its neighbor qubit, for instance. And this can be a quantum effect or a classical effect. You can also have leakage that appear. So there is like a lot of noise that can happen on your system, and you need a way to describe this noise. Usually what you use is a density matrix. So here I have written the density matrix of a pure state and the density matrix of a pure state which has depolarization in it. And here, just to fix the ID, so this is the type of measurement that we do in the lab to measure the density matrix fully. So it's possible to measure the density matrix. One of the issues is that you see it already is that for the state vector, we have 2^(n-1) complex parameter, and now we have 4^(n) real parameter. So now, like, the question is, how can we include this into a circuit formalism? So algebraically, what you can use is you can use the cross operator representation, which you can always find for some type of noise. You can always find a representation like this of your noise or your operation. And here is an example of the general depolarizing noise, and which act on the density matrix. Now, like, something which at least personally I find a bit less nice is that it's not just a matrix multiplication, it's a bit more complicated and it's a bit harder to keep track of it. So for this, usually, like, what we like to do experimentally is that we try to get process matrices. So what you do is, instead of saying that density matrix is a matrix, you say it's a vector. And here you have, like, a vector representation of the density matrix in the poly basis, where each of the coordinates is just a trace of the density matrix with a poly operator. And this gives you the nice property that no noise and unitary operation are, again, a matrix multiplication on your density matrix. So here, for instance, I'm giving the the poly transfer matrix of the full depolarization noise. What I can do is I can, like, if you look on the bottom here, I can represent once again the circuit with its noise, with just matrices associated with each of those blocks. So here I have the Adamard matrix that I had before. I have the noise associated. So here you see that I have put the noise on the 2 qubits because I have the noise associated with my Adamard gate. So maybe I have some small miscalibration. I also can have, like, the decoherence effect. But I also include the other qubit, because what I'm saying is that maybe there is crosstalk. Maybe by doing the gate here, I'm actually inducing some error on the other qubit. So this is what I can represent with this. I have the C naught, and then I have the noise on the C naught. And so basically, we are back to the previous situation, and we can use the same type of same time of computation in order to calculate the circuit. But there is a few caveats: is that now we have much larger matrices, right? Now it's 4^(n) × 4^(n) matrices instead of 2^(n) × 2^n. And also, some error cannot be very well represented with this formalism. Like, for instance, if you want to have leakage, you will need to have process matrices. You will need to consider the density matrices with the extra level. And so this will actually complexify even more your calculation. You can have also TLS or fluctuator that will perturb your system and that will cause effect. And generally, like, this has a very hard time capturing noise which is correlated in time. So let's say that the error here depends on what's come before. So, like, all type of non-Markovian noise will be really hard to characterize with this type of model. And so just finally, just to fix a bit an image of what this is. So experimentally, we actually measure the subject. It's a bit expensive and it take quite some time, but we can do it. And for instance, here we did it on a 3-qubit Itofoli gate. And here I'm showing the poly transfer matrix, the ideal case that represent the process operation. And here I'm showing the pre-transfer of the error associated with our gate. So there is just a rescaling. So they are not so large, but you see that there is a bit of a structure still inside this. But we can use this then to simulate the noise on our circuit. So this was what I wanted to introduce. So now, without further ado, we will have Yipeng Huang talk about graphical model and logical abstraction for quantum system. Yipeng Huang is an assistant professor at the Rutgers University since 2020, and his research investigates on quantum computing and quantum architecture, and more specifically, and how to program, simulate, and debug those quantum computers. And so with this, I will leave the give the floor.
Great. Thanks, Alexis, for the great tutorial and introduction. Let me get my screen share up. All right, here we go. So I just want to mention that I welcome questions during the talk. In fact, I'll be pausing periodically to take questions. So if something is not clear, or if there's something I can annotate to clarify and help you understand what's going on, I super welcome that. All right. So the broader picture of this talk is in this area of quantum computer systems, right? So I think the colloquium here, the audience, we have people who are primarily working on algorithms and also people who primarily work with devices. And what's cool about doing quantum computing now is we are finally at the juncture where we can try to get algorithms to run on prototype machines. And so this starts to involve a whole section of computer science in terms of programming languages, in terms of computer architectures and microarchitectures, to build out all the layers that we need to efficiently use prototype machines, prototype quantum machines. And so here are just some aspects of regular computer, classical computer architecture that we need to bridge, right? So we need to have software frameworks. We need to have techniques for debugging and analyzing programs. And we need to have sound characterizations of the underlying hardware so that we know how to compile programs to run on prototypes. Right. So this ties into some of the seminar talks that you at Berkeley CIQC have seen recently. So for example, right, I believe Professor Yongshan Ding at Yale, Professor Swami Tanu at Wisconsin, and Professor Fred Chong at UChicago all recently talked about several aspects of this. So this talk is going to be about simulators and about intermediate representations. Right. And specifically what that means, you know, this is a slide that I use to describe some of the abstractions that we need to build out the quantum computer stack. Right. And the areas that I think are super interesting are in programming languages and simulation and architecture. And here specifically, we're going to talk about intermediate representation. So different ways to take a quantum algorithm, which typically is expressed as proofs and equations. Sometimes you'll see quantum circuits, right? And as it turns out, we actually need more representations in addition to just regular quantum circuits to help us understand and analyze and simulate quantum programs, quantum algorithms. Right. And also this talk also talks about simulators too. All right. So why do I focus on program abstractions or representations? Well, as it turns out, my feeling is that quantum circuits are really just only one way of looking at quantum algorithm descriptions. Right. So as Alexis has mentioned, there's also other representations useful in different areas. So some of them include, for example, the Heisenberg representation in terms of stabilizers and Clifford set, which is useful in analyzing quantum error correction. These models, such as tensor networks, graphical models, and Bayesian networks, are important in many areas of quantum circuit simulation. And what's new with this talk today in my work is that, as it turns out, these graphical models have really deep ties to classical computing in the area of satisfiability and in Boolean formulas. And that actually becomes kind of an underpinning mechanism that allows us to borrow techniques from classical computing to do circuit simulation, right? So, you know, here's an overview of what this talk is all about. I went through the pictures at the bottom, which is a kind of teaser of what's coming up ahead. So in this talk, I'll talk about how noisy circuits can be mapped into graphical models like Bayesian networks, and how that may be useful for encoding some types of particularly difficult to represent noise, right? Different kinds of noise that's especially difficult to model, we can actually very naturally model them as graphical models. This allows us to tie it to classical Boolean logic and allows us to do different types of minimization, and that helps us, as the case study, do simulation of the quantum circuits. Okay, so this is kind of an overview of what's coming up ahead and what are the key, like, cool ideas that should be in this talk. All right, so I'll take a quick pause here, just in case anybody has questions before launching ahead. All right, so the specific case study for this paper, for this talk, is in the area of simulating variational algorithms, right? And I'll motivate why it's particularly interesting and important to study variational algorithms in a few set of slides. And then I'll talk about how the existing circuit simulators that people have developed have no ability to specifically simulate variational algorithms, right? So there's a mismatch here in terms of what types of tools have been thoroughly developed for quantum circuit simulation, and what types of workloads, what types of simulation workloads we should pay attention to because they're important in the near term. And after kind of talking about how though there's a mismatch there, then I'll talk about how the connections from circuits to logic formulas allows us to do quantum circuit simulation. All right, so first let's talk about variational algorithms. This should be familiar to many of you, but I just want to take a moment to remind ourselves of why they're important and what's so special about them. All right, so variational algorithms are a type of quantum algorithm which we think would be useful in the near term. And they would be useful in the near term because they match well with the properties and kind of limitations of the quantum computer prototypes that we will have in the near future, right? So the prototypes that we have will have a limited number of qubits on the order of hundreds, 100, 200 qubits. They will have unreliable operations. The qubits themselves will have limited coherence time on the order of milliseconds to seconds. And because of both limitations in the number of qubits available, and also because of the reliability of the operations, there wouldn't be any facilities for quantum error correction. And so we want to have algorithms that can run on the prototype computers that we do have. And this is kind of tricky because a lot of the famous algorithms that we would study in quantum computing, the motivating algorithms that the broader general public are familiar with, like Grover's search and Shor's factoring, those types of algorithms are completely infeasible. And instead, what we have are these variational algorithms, which borrow on the unique traits of both classical computers and quantum computers, combining them to get useful computation from quantum prototypes. All right, so the basic scheme of how this progresses is we use both a quantum computer or a classical computer. The quantum computer evaluates a objective function or a Hamiltonian matrix from some system that we want to study. The classical computer draws samples from each of the observables from the quantum computer. It evaluates some objective function and then comes up with a new set of parameters to drive back into the quantum machine. And this whole process runs thousands of times to both get different samples of the observables and also to drive the optimization routine. Right, so we can say a little bit more about how this is different from typical algorithms. in that these variation algorithms, first of all, are supposed to run even when the quantum computer prototypes themselves are noisy. And so if you're trying to characterize how well a variational algorithm runs on a prototype computer, the modeling of noise becomes a very important property. Second of all, we want to simulate the quantum part of the algorithm many times, right? We want to study how well is a variational algorithm going to run. And as part of that simulation, you have your ansatz or your Hamiltonian that you're going to program into the quantum computer. And this ansatz, the structure of the circuit itself, is completely fixed. And what does change between each run are the initial conditions or the parameters. And finally, there's another property of variational algorithms, which is typically because the quantum prototypes have limited reliability and endurance, the types of circuits that they'll run have relatively more qubits and relatively shallow circuits. So shallow circuits means relatively few gates on each qubit. And there's two most prominent types of variational algorithms. So there's the variational eigensolver, VQE, which is useful in quantum chemistry, studying quantum systems that are described using the Schrodinger equation. And there's also QAOA, which is a kind of subset of variational eigensolvers. And using QAOA, you can solve problems that are relating to constraint satisfaction. So problems such as max sat and max cut. They have mappings where you can approximate the solutions to those problems using QAOA. Okay, so I'll take a pause here to see if there's any questions about the types of workloads that we're interested in.
So I had a question.
Sure, John.
You're clearly focusing on these because they kind of make sense in the current environment. I'm assuming that some of the techniques that you're going to talk about for simulation are kind of in general applicable, even as we move forward in scaling and you know, better devices or whatever.
Sure, right. So this is kind of to address this particular concern, right? So in the world of quantum circuit simulators, there's by now thousands of implementations. And what we observed is that most of them were entirely geared for noiseless circuits, so completely geared for ideal circuit simulation. And then also, they are meant for simulating supremacy circuits, right? So the very most advanced simulators are developed by people who want to refute claims about quantum advantage, quantum supremacy. And so they are extremely optimized for a very specific class of quantum circuits. And here, you know, we started from a different viewpoint, which is, well, if you want to study variational algorithms, what's so special about variational algorithms, and how might you help simulate them?
Okay.
So that ties into our next kind of lead-in chapter here, right? So what is this task of circuit simulation? Why is it important? And why do we want to have a new class of simulators specifically geared toward them? Right. So, you know, this is kind of a motivating slide for why we want to simulate a quantum computer, right? Right. If you have a quantum computer, just then use the quantum computer. What's the point of doing all this mucking around using a classical computer to try simulating them? And if you think about classical computing, it's always been the fact that the current generation of classical computers help design and validate and simulate and analyze, understand the next generation of classical computers, right? So, you know, in the task of designing a microchip for the next generation of CPUs, you would use a existing less powerful computer that you have now to simulate that. And this is going to necessarily be part of the quantum computing ecosystem too, right? Until we have algorithms on quantum computers that are intended for simulating quantum computers, right? Quantum computer simulation of quantum computers, we will still have to rely on some form of classical computer simulation to test the next generation of quantum computers. And as John's question had highlighted before, right? So my answer to John's question before, right? So as it turns out, the kinds of simulators that we have now, they're mostly geared for simulating ideal circuits, and the most advanced ones are geared for simulating supremacy circuits, a very specific kind of random quantum circuit. And as it turns out, for variational algorithms, the kinds of properties that variational algorithms have are completely different. Right? So number one, the simulation technique, the circuits that you represent need to capture noise. And this noise can come in many different models. It could be balanced noise in the form of bit flip noise and phase flip noise. It can be bias noise in the form of amplitude damping or phase damping. And it can even be correlated noise, which, as it turns out, ends up being a very interesting kind of noise model. Number two, right? So the properties of running variational algorithms on quantum computers. The second property is you're going to end up running the variational algorithm circuit, the quantum circuit itself, many thousands of times. And each time the structure of the circuit will be the same, but you want to give it different parameters, whether you're running VQE or QAOA, and different initial assignments to quantum states. And so you want to do some kind of work where you can take the structure and somehow use that structure in each of your simulation runs repeatedly across different simulations. Number three, right? So number three is sometimes you're not really interested in seeing the overall state vector or the density matrix of the quantum program. You're not interested in seeing the final state across all the qubits for the quantum circuit. And instead, you want to simulate what a quantum computer might do, which is just draw samples from that final state vector, that final probability distribution. And so we want to build a simulator that somehow supports these interesting traits. And so we're going to revisit what existing simulators there are and think about if they support these unique traits, right? So let's talk about what types of simulators, what types of styles of quantum circuit simulation are common today. All right, so in this slide here, I'll give examples of two. The first is in the style of the Schrodinger view of quantum circuits, quantum mechanics, where we view the quantum circuit like so. We phrase them as standard quantum circuits. And as Alexis's tutorial had highlighted, what this circuit, when we see this, we immediately know, there's state vectors in it. The gates are unitary matrices. And so the task of simulating this circuit is a task of multiplying unitary matrices against long state vectors. And this is very good, right? So this is how we're taught and study, how we study quantum circuits. And this has some nice properties and some undesirable properties too, right? So if we match them against the properties of variational circuits that we want to study. So number one, the state vector view of quantum circuit simulation is always going to keep track of the entire state vector, right? So the state of the simulation scales exponentially with respect to the number of qubits you have. And so if you have relatively many qubits you want to simulate, but actually the circuits are very shallow, the state vector simulation is going to still keep trying to keep track of the whole state vector and won't scale well with respect to the width of the circuit, the number of qubits. Part two, right? So state vector simulation, it just sees the whole circuit. There's no way to analyze the quantum circuit in some way to do repeated simulation, right? So every time you start up a new state vector simulation, it's going to be a whole new state vector. And from there, you're going to multiply unitary matrices until you have the final simulated outcome. And what it does offer, though, right? So the green checkbox here shows that, well, fortunately, so one nice property of this style of simulation is since you have the whole state vector, you can efficiently draw samples from it, right? So you can square the amplitudes and find the probability and then do a kind of rejection sampling to draw samples from that state vector. Let's contrast this to another style of quantum circuit simulation. So this is in the Feynman view of quantum circuits. And here we look at quantum circuits, not as quantum circuits directly, but we instead interpret them as tensor networks. Right. So overall, the semantics of these two diagrams are completely the same. But instead of gates, we now have tensors. And the tensors are basically generalizations of matrices. Right. So we have scalars and vectors and matrices and beyond, rank three tensors, rank four tensors, and so forth. Inside the tensor, here's an example of a tensor. So this is a tensor for the Hadamard gate. Inside the tensor, you have all the same elements as the unitary matrices. And we just reorganize the kind of coefficients in a different way that emphasizes how the tensor takes its inputs to its outputs, right? So this is kind of like the same information as the unitary matrices, but instead we kind of label the indices explicitly. And so for something like a two-qubit gate, the CNOT gate, this will become a rank four tensor. The number of edges coming out of each tensor node indicates its rank. And the CNOT gate here is going to be a rank four tensor. Again, it encompasses all the same information as the unitary matrix view of the quantum gate, but we explicitly label how it takes the combinations of input states and takes them to the output states, right? So the quantum circuit now is going to be, you have your tensors and we connect them together into a tensor network. So the tensor network emphasizes how states are propagated between the unitary matrices. And now, Now that we have these tensor networks, we do the standard type of operation that we can do when we have tensor networks, which is a task of tensor network contraction. Right. So what this does is it takes the nodes in the tensor network and it combines them into fewer but higher rank tensors. And so here in this specific example here, we've contracted away the Q0M1 state, the first moment state on the qubit zero, so that we end up with a new rank four tensor, which has absorbed both the CNOT gate and the Hadamard gate. And this rank four tensor is going to encompass the overall overall way in which it takes input states to the output states. And you can see the output tensor, the contracted tensor on the right here. And again, it encompasses all the same information as the unitary matrix that describes the overall quantum circuit, but it's more explicit in terms of how it takes input states and takes them to output states. All right, so that was a summary of tensor network style quantum circuit simulation. And tensor network style quantum circuit simulation has been extremely important in studying random circuits and studying quantum supremacy circuits, in that they're able to do some things that state vector simulators cannot. So number one, the key attribute that it has in favor against state vector simulators is the tensor network simulators, instead of finding the whole state vector, right? And instead, each time only finds exactly one amplitude, right? So the overall memory costs of storing the whole state is much lower. And so for that reason, the most advanced circuit simulators are based off of tensor network contraction. And in fact, some even more advanced simulators use a kind of combination of both matrix vector simulation and also tensor network contraction. All right. And just to kind of round out the rest of the slide here, so we want to talk about do tensor network contraction-based simulators address the properties of variational algorithms? And so as a, in my kind of assessment here, right? So we're not able to use tensor network contraction to either do repeated simulation or do a kind of efficient sampling. Right? So we want to have a new style of simulation that addresses the key properties of variational algorithms geared for near-term algorithms, NISQ algorithms. All right, so I'll pause here and take questions before moving on. Is there anything I can kind of clarify or annotate to help motivate the rest of this talk? All right. So now what we're going to move into is a kind of series of transformations, right? So transformations are useful in classical computing because you can take one representation of a program or an algorithm and represent it in different languages. And the different viewpoints allow you to possibly use different tools and to see different symmetries or different analyses that each of those representations can support. Right, so here we're gonna take the variational algorithm circuits that have noise in them, and we're going to perform a series of transformations that allow us to more efficiently sample them or simulate them according to the properties of variational algorithms, right? So this is going to be a sequence of transformations. Each of them addresses one of the particular traits of variation algorithms. So first of all, we want to represent noise. And so we're going to have a graphical model representation that can represent quantum states and also noise at the same time. The next part is we want to simulate the variational algorithm circuits multiple times, thousands of times. And so we're going to follow a procedure called knowledge compilation, originating in classical inference that takes graphical models and turn them into a compiled representation that allows you to repeatedly simulate them multiple times. So you do a kind of pre-compilation, pre-calculation step that extracts structure, and using that compiled object, you can do queries repeatedly more efficiently. And then as it turns out, this approach also allows you to do a kind of Markov chain Monte Carlo sampling on the states. And this is also nicely tailored to variational algorithms, since you are also interested in simulating samples and not necessarily seeing the overall state. Right, so let's dive right in, where we're going to first take quantum circuits, and we're going to take a viewpoint where they are in the form of a Bayesian network that also can encapsulate noise. Right. So Bayesian networks are a kind of graphical model. In general, probabilistic graphical models and also encompass a lot of different other important models in classical AI. So including tensor networks, undirected models like Markov networks, and also some types of neural networks can also be represented as graphical models. Bayesian networks are kind of a early and basic example of graphical model. So what we can use them for is they represent our understanding, our beliefs about the world, right? So we have a graph, the nodes represent events that have truth values. And whether or not these events are true or false depend on their dependent variables. And we can model the causal relationship between these events using directed edges, right? So for example here, whether or not the sprinkler is on is going to depend on whether or not it's raining, right? So maybe your sprinkler has a kind of sensor such that if it's raining, the probability of it turning on is going to be lower. And if it's not raining, it will turn on more likely, right? So you can use these models to represent beliefs about the world. You can even have techniques that allow you to train for different structures of the Bayesian network and also to train for different parameters in the network. So these Bayesian networks end up being a very nice model for noisy quantum circuits, right? So first of all, if you want to model a Bayesian, use a Bayesian network to model quantum circuits, we have to represent two things, right? So first of all, we have to represent the quantum states and the gates. So these are the circuits without noise, and then you have to model the noise itself, right? So in order to model the quantum states and the transitions between states in the form of the unitary matrices, we follow the kind of semantics of tensor networks as before, right? So in this Bayesian network, we'll have states. We have two qubits, Q0, Q1. These qubits take on different states as the time progresses, and they are linked together causally using directed edges, which emphasize the kind of time progression of the quantum circuit. And within each node, you have tables, right? So in classical AI, these would be called conditional probability tables. And the semantics of conditional probability actually generalize to complex numbers in the form of amplitudes. So we can, instead of having conditional probability tables, we have these things called conditional amplitude tables, which are essentially the tensors, right? So these are the same as the tensors in the tensor network representation of quantum circuits. All right, so here we've captured the semantics of the quantum states and the unitary matrices. And what we want to do next is we want to also capture the semantics of noise, right? So for noise, what we can do, right? So in this picture, I have specifically generalized amplitude damping noise, but let's think about a simpler example, say simple bit flip noise, right? So bit flip noise has a single parameter, the probability of a bit flip. That gets encoded as a random variable, a new node in the Bayesian network. And that gets connected into the Bayesian network through a node that governs, that describes the bit flip noise. So this would be useful for modeling balanced noise, like both bit flip noise and also phase flip noise. But we know that in addition to balanced noise, there's also biased noise, right? So biased noise would be something like amplitude damping, phase damping, and generalized amplitude damping. And so for those, the kind of way to model them is a little bit more tricky. Right, so what amplitude damping, for example, what it inherently models is a kind of unintended measurement. Right, so you have a qubit state, the qubit gets entangled with some additional physical object other than what's in the qubit circuit, the qubits in the circuit. And so your qubit state gets entangled with the outside world. And we can model this as a kind of a measurement process, right? So if you go to descriptions of amplitude damping, there's actually a nice little widget that allows you to think of the amplitude damping channel as a quantum circuit involving a environment where the qubit that you're trying to model gets entangled with the environment and that becomes a kind of, and then that becomes a measurement outcome on the environment. Right, so using that basic principle, we can come back and model these noise events like amplitude damping and generalized amplitude damping as qubit states, entangling with other random variables, modeling the environment. And after that point, the qubit states are going to have amplitude damping noise. Right, so this covers all the basic types of noise channels that you might find in, for example, Nielsen Chuang. Right, so it'll cover bit flip noise, phase flip noise, amplitude damping, generalized amplituding, and so forth. And what's nice is, in addition to those noise models, we can also model some emergent models with noise too, right? So as it turns out, now that we're able to harness prototype quantum computers, we're finding that correlated noise is actually the kind of the most interesting and persistent and difficult to model noise. So correlated noise can come in two forms. One is spatially correlated, and the other is temporally correlated, right? So spatially correlated would be like at any single moment, the effect of a gate ends up having noise events happening on two different qubit states, right? So in a Bayesian network viewpoint, this is actually pretty straightforward to model just as well, right? So you have a new random variable coin toss that affects simultaneously two different qubit states at once spatially. And perhaps what's most interesting is you can also use the Bayesian network model to model temporally correlated noise too. So non-Markovian noise processes end up being, again, a coin flip, but the coin flip becomes a conditional event that impacts multiple qubit states across time. Right? So in classical AI, people have been using Bayesian networks to model all kinds of correlated processes, and it's kind of the go-to language for those types of processes. And it should also be used for correlated processes in noise modeling just as well. Okay, so I'll take a pause there to take questions before moving onward. So what we've done so far is we've taken quantum circuits and different kinds of noise processes and mapped them onto graphical models that very naturally capture things like dependent events.
So I had a brief question here. So these arrows in your graphical model, unlike the classical case though, are superposed states, right? So what's coming through there is a superposition of various things.
So superposition, so I'll use this slide to kind of explain that, right? So people ask this a lot, right? So we have Bayesian networks, and so what happens to things like the superposition that's so important? What happens to the entanglement that's so important? Well, superposition is ultimately itself a kind of probability distribution, right? So it's also a kind of simultaneous event that has this kind of simultaneous event is naturally and is important in modeling probabilistic models just as well, right? So all we really had to do is take probability, and well, we have probabilities that are not just real numbers, but instead we have probabilities that are complex amplitudes, and the Bayesian networks are perfectly happy with that. So using the Bayesian network model, you can still model superpositions. It doesn't require any modifications to the semantics of the graphical model. Things like superposition are naturally modeled. And then things like entanglement, it becomes a kind of correlation across multiple random variables. And that is naturally captured in the semantics of graphical models just as well. It's not a different kind of semantic.
So this technique though can handle entanglement properly in your simulation?
Right. So Yeah, so you know, the kind of, just kind of a backstory here, which is, well, we can follow the mathematically what's the mathematics of something like a Bayesian network algorithm, like variable elimination. Go back to the source definition of what variable elimination is, and you can perform it on a quantum circuit that models the Bell state circuit, and you'll get exactly the same final distribution as the Bell state circuit should get, which is, you know, 0, 0, 1, 1 equal superposition. So that's one validation, right? So the things like exact inference via variable elimination give exactly the right results. And also, we do this kind of validation programmatically too.
So maybe my question is there a single line description of why the tensor model is faster and more scalable than the more, you know, what you were calling the Schrodinger simulation? I mean, because you're still got some things that are exponential state, or maybe that's the part that I'm kind of missing.
So I guess the single line is we can borrow AI techniques. We can borrow techniques from classical inference and allow us to manipulate the graphical models.
Okay. All right.
So that's one aspect to it. The other aspect is that, well, the graphical models like Bayesian network, tensor networks, they kind of do a different trade-off between space and time. So instead of keeping track of the whole state vector, the graphical models, they only find single amplitudes at once. And so it doesn't incur the exponential cost in storage, but instead it pays it in the form of time cost, having to find each amplitude in the whole state vector separately. Okay, so that was the first part of this translation. So we talked about how graphical models can model circuits, they can model noise, and even new and important types of noise, like correlated noise. And what's nice now is, now that we've done that translation, people have studied Bayesian networks for decades and decades. And there are many, many, many powerful tools for Bayesian networks. And one such tool is people wanted to do repeated inference on Bayesian networks. Right? They want to do a query a million times, and each query is going to only be different in terms of some parameters or some truth variables. And so is there some way to take a Bayesian network, compile it into a object that you can query repeatedly, and just plug in new numbers and get queries more efficiently? And that technique is called knowledge compilation. And it proceeds in kind of three steps, right? So first we're gonna take the Bayesian network, and then we're gonna turn it into a form represented as Boolean formulas that allow us to use satisfiability techniques to crunch it down. And then we're gonna take that Boolean formula, and we can try to enumerate the different assignments to variables that all satisfy the Boolean formula. And this becomes an object that we can query repeatedly for new queries. And so using that, we can do both circuit simulation, and we can do both, and we can also do sampling. And so the first step of this is we want to take the Bayesian networks and we want to turn them into Boolean formulas. And one canonical form for Boolean formulas will be CNF, conjunctive normal form. And the way we do this, or why this is useful, is, well, if you think about the circuit and capture all its semantics as a logic formula, you can borrow satisfiability solvers to crunch down this formula. And the deeper reason why this all works is you have this Boolean formula as Boolean variables, like, you know, is this true or that is true or this is false? These different combinations of true and false that satisfy the Boolean formula in the form of CNF, each satisfying assignment becomes one Feynman path through the quantum circuit. And the task of doing quantum circuit simulation becomes an equivalent task in computer science called weighted model counting. And doing weighted model counting gives you the amplitudes for the quantum circuit for each set of qubit state assignments. All right, so let's dive this into this a little bit more detail. So we have the semantics of the Bayesian network here. And what we'll do is we're not going to take each of the semantics of each state and each gate and turn them into logical equations, logical formulas, right? So here, the first set of clauses emphasize that these two variables are mutually exclusive, right? So this isn't mutually exclusive in the way that, you know, we say that there can't be a superposition between the two. This is just mutually exclusive in the sense that these two possibilities are opposites of each other, right? So the possibility that Q0 at moment zero takes on qubit state zero is exclusive or is opposite of that same qubit state taking on this value of ket one. Then we go on and represent the semantics of the gates, right? So combinations of inputs and outputs lead to new variables that encode a weight or a coefficient. And these coefficients come from the qubit gates. So for example, here you have the coefficients for the Hadamard gate. And when in your Boolean formula, you see both of these being true, this entailment here tells you that this set of variable assignments is going to incur a weight, a complex valued weight of 1/√2. And we can continue on for the other qubit state, the other gates as well. So here for the CNOT gate, its semantics are that if you see combinations of qubit state like Q0M2=0 and Q1M0, the control and the target qubits are 0, 0, the target qubit at the next moment in time is going to be 0. Right, so we've taken the semantics of qubits and we've taken the semantics of gates and turned them into logical formula clauses. And what we do next is we turn them all into disjunctive clauses, right? So there's a standard way to take entailment and turn them into OR clauses. And then we conjoin all of them together. So we slam all the semantics together into one giant CNF that captures all of the logical formulas as before. And now in this new large CNF, each set of variable assignments that is such that the CNF evaluates to true becomes one Feynman path through the quantum circuit that's consistent with the semantics of the quantum circuit. Okay, so I'll pause here to take questions about this. All right, so this is a very powerful idea, right? So it's powerful in the sense that, you know, the kind of quantum tools and simulators and compilers that we all have so far start from the baseline of we're reasoning about quantum circuits, right? So they end up being thinking about the circuits themselves and represent, you know, the state vectors and how they evolved according to circuit semantics. And here we're showing that, well, in addition to the circuits view or the graphical model view, the semantics can also be represented completely as a logical formula as well. So what this allows us to do is, well, we want to proceed and follow the technique of knowledge compilation, right? And what this is we want to come up with a new data structure that enumerates valid paths through the quantum circuit and allow us to do circuit simulation. So we want to find amplitudes and we want to draw samples. And so again, right, so this is borrowing from classical AI in the form of knowledge compilation. And the kinds of knowledge compilation tools that have been developed for Bayesian networks allow us to do pretty remarkable reduction in the representation. So here I have two data structures. So these are called arithmetic circuits. The one on the left enumerates all the valid paths through a kind of, for example, a QAOA quantum circuit. And we can try to do this naively. And we see there's kind of a combinatorial explosion of all the possible valid assignments through the quantum circuit. And then we can also turn on different kinds of reductions. So we can take things like determinism and also combination or come up with more intelligent ways to order the variables, leading to more compactified representations such as this one. And so we can try doing this kind of compilation or reduction across different quantum circuits. So here I'm plotting the size of the compiled representation versus the size of the quantum circuit itself. And this compiler is intelligent enough that it can detect the different kinds of structures in each quantum algorithm. So here I'm plotting quantum circuits for random circuits, which are useful in studying quantum supremacy claims. And we also have circuits coming from Grover's algorithms and Shor's algorithm. And so, for example, something like Shor's algorithm, it has a lot of CNOT gates, a lot of Toefli gates in the arithmetic circuit, in the quantum circuit for evaluating modular exponentiation. And so that leads to a lot of determinism that can be crunched away. So this is like seeing the sparsity structure in the unitary matrix and compiling that away so that we have a more compactified representation. And so what exactly does this buy us? So I'm going to pause here before moving onward to talk about how exactly we do inference and circuit simulation on this compiled representation. Okay. So now let's go into more detail, right? So let's dive in and actually see, now that we have this compiled object, how do we actually use this to do circuit simulation? And so here's a really small example of a compiled representation. This is the representation for a noisy Bell state circuit. So the same circuit that we had used to build the Bayesian network as before. And in this representation, as the arithmetic circuit, we have, it has a structure that's in general a directed acyclic graph. And in the graph, we have nodes. The nodes themselves can have different things. So the nodes can have truth values, right? So truth variable assignments saying that, for example, whether or not a noise event took place, whether or not a qubit state is cat zero or cat one, and so forth. And some of the leaves have in them weights, right? So these are weights that could come from noise events, or they could come from the coefficients in the unitary matrices. These leaves are joined together in these nodes that have arithmetic operations in them. So multiplies and adds and multiplies and adds. And what these tell us is exactly what computation we need to do to find one amplitude, right? So in effect, we've taken the semantics for doing quantum circuit simulation, and we've compiled it into this data structure that tells us exactly what arithmetic operations we need to do to compute one amplitude, or to compute one probability amplitude, right? So this pre-compilation gets rid of a lot of like decision-making on, gee, now I have to do state vector multiplication, iterate across these rows and across these columns and so forth. All that control knowledge of what you need to do gets compiled into this data structure that tells you beforehand what the computation needs to be. And so the task of finding one qubit state's amplitude becomes, well, you go into this data structure and you plug in the truth values for the truth variables. And then, true values to one, false values to zero. And then you just multiply and add following the data structure all the way up to the root node. And then out from the root node, you'll get the amplitude for that set of qubit state assignments. So if here in this example, we have, suppose the random variable for the noise event did happen and that the qubit state at Q0, M2 is ket one, qubit state at ket one, Q1, M3 is ket one, then this data structure tells you the amplitude for that is this value here. Right. And so this is super effective because, right, just like the tensor network simulations, we're able to find only one amplitude at a time instead of keeping track of a whole state vector. And also, we've done a lot of pre-compilation. We've taken the structure of the variational algorithm's structure and turned it into this static structure that we can just plug in new parameters for each simulation and do simulation repeatedly without having to do this pre-compilation. All right, so I'll pause here to take any questions. Is there anything I can kind of clarify here or to annotate so that we can continue onward? Okay, so finally, we want to tackle the last property of variational algorithms, right? Which is that, well, instead of having to find the whole state vector, finding the whole wave function, we're actually interested in doing kind of sampling. And the sampling proceeds as a kind of Markov chain Monte Carlo, right? So you come up with initial trial state, and you decide using MCMC and Gibbs sampling whether or not to move on to a different sample for the next state. And this is also something that's very nicely supported by the compiled representation. So the way this would work is that, as before, a upward traversal through the data structure gives you one amplitude, and then a downward traversal will give you the transition probabilities for the different states. And so we can take the machinery for doing Gibbs sampling, which was offered on classical AI, intended for classical AI, and it also works for sampling these quantum states as well. And so let's recap, right? So we've taken the task of quantum circuit simulation, which typically we think about, okay, it's a state vector multiplication and so forth, or we think about it as a kind of tensor network contraction. And here we've turned that into a very different task of a kind of graph traversal on this compiled representation. Right? So this is kind of the significance of this, which is, well, we can take these quantum tasks, draw deep analogies from them to tasks that we've been doing in classical AI, and the semantics carry over and the kind of machinery and the tools carry over just as well. So that's to wrap up the kind of steps that we took to get to here, right? So we've shown that how quantum circuits, they have very different views, that you can think of them as graphical models, as logic formulas and so forth. And now we want to evaluate, all right, so how well does this all work? Right? So first of all, is it even accurate? And so, as I said before, the semantics for graphical models is perfectly fine for both real valued probability and also for complex valued amplitudes. The semantics for an algorithm like variable elimination for exact inference carries over. And so we're able to use this formalism to simulate a large set of benchmarks where we can do Pauli gates to include something like Deutsch-Chossa's algorithm all the way to QFT and Schwarz and Grover's algorithm. And we built this as a open source simulation backend that ports to Google CIRC, right? So Google CIRC provides facilities for different simulator backends. So you can develop toward that interface and then use Google CIRC to validate against its test suite to certify that this is a valid quantum circuit simulator, right? So this is the validation that this idea works. And we also compare against a couple established quantum circuit simulators in the form of both state vector, matrix vector multiplication-based simulators here in the blue-green trace, and also tensor network-based simulators in the form here as the orange and yellow trace. Right, so I'm plotting the time it takes to draw samples, 1,000 samples, from the final wave function, plotting that against the number of qubits that we're simulating. Right, so this workload here is a QAOA algorithm for max cut. And for the largest instances, we're doing this for something like 32 qubits. Right, and so as you can see, the state vector simulator, as the number of qubits grows, it starts to incur the storage cost of storing the whole state vector. And so its time cost scales exponentially with respect to the number of qubits. Both ours and also the tensor network simulators don't have to represent the whole state vector. And so it doesn't have that kind of exponential growth. But because we're able to pre-compile the structure into a different representation and kind of reduce the workload, we are able to also be tensor network simulators just as well. Okay, so any questions before I move into wrap up and kind of future work directions?
So could you, so is your technique here the purple one? Sorry, I missed.
Yeah, so our technique is knowledge compilation based quantum circuit simulation. So that's the purple trace.
Gotcha. So it really does well as the number of qubits get much larger.
Right. Right. So I should also caveat kind of what are the weaknesses here too, right? So the caveat here is this technique is very sensitive to qubit depth. Right. So this is true for both our simulator and also for tensor network simulators. The idea being that as you increase depth, increasing the more layers of QAOA that you have to simulate, this data structure is still going to have to enumerate all those paths. And so it's very sensitive to deeper and deeper circuits. Right? But there's still a kind of point where this is useful because in the near term, variational algorithms, we don't envision using them for really deep circuits either. Okay, so recap, right? The kind of key insight of all this is, well, we have quantum circuits. And beyond quantum circuits, they can also be represented as graphical models and logical formulas and all these different types of representations that allow us to do different types of analysis and compilation on them. Right? And this belongs to kind of a broader picture of, well, in some sense, you know, these other viewpoints are all useful in different areas of quantum computing, and there should be interesting connections between them. Okay. So one kind of area that I'm interested in is, suppose that you have a tensor network simulator. Right? Tensor network simulator, the simulation cost that it will see is sensitive to a parameter about the tensor network called tree width. Right? So in the tensor network view of things, simulation cost is exponential with respect to tree width. But what's interesting is if you take a tensor network simulator and give it a completely Clifford quantum circuit, in the sense that the whole quantum circuit has just Clifford gates in it, all the states are stabilized, the tensor network simulator is not going to be able to see the stabilizer structure, right? So in some sense, these different formalisms for example, between the stabilizer and the tensor network formalisms, there are synergies and kind of blind spots between them that could be kind of bridged together, right? So my work here, representing them as Boolean formulas, is a new kind of direction to represent quantum circuits and for representing noise processes. And so I find the kind of research directions of finding connections between these very interesting. There's one more kind of connection, right, or kind of future type of directions that this may go to, which is, well, now that we've represented quantum circuits as Bayesian networks and also as a kind of weighted model counting task on these data structures, this becomes a completely new way that we can develop hardware accelerators, so specialized classical hardware specifically geared for quantum circuit simulation and weighted model counting and so forth. Right? So this becomes a new direction for us to think about how classical hardware can be redesigned to specifically help with the simulation task. Again, this all belongs to a broader picture of, well, we want to bridge the gap between algorithms and prototypes. And so we need to build out the systems layers to do this prototyping and experimentation. And here specifically in this talk, we talked about simulators and intermediate representations, but more broadly, right? This is a wider area of quantum computer architecture and systems where we're trying to fill out all these tools. And so with that, I'd like to thank all my collaborators here at Rutgers. So this paper was specifically a joint work with Professor Martinosi of Princeton, Stephen Holson and Professor Todd Milstein and Professor Vandenbroek at UCLA. Stephen has since gone on to be a new professor at Northeastern. And more broadly, you know, these are the people I work with. And so with that, I'll thank everybody on the line for taking the time to listen in, and happy to take questions about any part of it.
Great, thank you. Alexis, did you want to take over handling the questions or?
Yep, I can do that. So does anyone have any questions?
You know, I do, I actually have a question. So fast forward 10 years or 20 years or whatever it needs to where we have a lot of qubits. They're less noisy, but we also have enough qubits, we can start putting error correction codes on them. You know, so that's kind of very different from our current noisy domain here, if for no other reason than we have enough qubits to put them on error correction. How do these techniques fit in that scenario where we have sort of active error suppression because there's continuous correction going on? So the bits ideally are, you know, the error corrected bits are ideally very noise, almost noise free, but there's a whole bunch of, you know, bits underneath the covers that are a little noisy. So would this kind of a technique work in that future environment, do you think, or what are your thoughts there?
Well, so this is simulating quantum computer circuits and processes underneath the error correction, right? So that even once we have QECC, we still need to model the error correction code itself, right? So maybe what you're saying is the most important workload for MISQ qubits right now and for this type of technique is not so much VQE and QALA, right? The most important workload that we need to study is, can this simulate a QECC protocol? And I think that's where that would tie in.
Well, in particular, one thing that's different when you have error correction going on is there's a whole bunch of measurement kind of going on continuously. And you're kind of right, because you gotta measure syndromes, and then you're doing something in response to that. The techniques you're talking about here are kind of, there are no measurements in the middle, from what I can tell, right? So this might be a slightly different
Yeah, so there are definitely measurements in the middle. So let me back up to here. Right, so this is actually a good idea, right? I think this is super interesting. Right, so already, like some types of noise processes, like amplitude damping, this is a kind of entanglement with a environment qubit and a measurement on that environment qubit. And so we're already modeling amplitude damping, generalized amplitude damping. And so the kinds of measurements that take that happen deliberately because it's a QECC protocol might be able to capture it that way too. Right, so the emphasis here is that amplitude damping, it's modeled as entanglement with the environment qubit. This measurement outcome becomes a random variable encoded in, for example, this random variable here that says if the measurement on the environment qubit is 0 or 1, and that comes back and updates the quantum state. So this could be a useful model for QECC.
Because I'm thinking as we get to that domain with lots more bits, you know, we're still going to want to figure out whether we have the right or sufficient error correction or whatever, especially when you can vary the number of levels or whatever. So simulating errors to an extent that could deal with really large numbers of physical qubits seems like that's important moving forward, of course. So.
Yeah, it's interesting. And I generally take the viewpoint that actually, you know, exactly as you say, QECC protocols should really be the main workload that we study for a lot of these things.
Alrighty, do we have any other questions?
So I also had a question about like, so it seems that there is a compilation, right? At the beginning, you kind of need to first do like a compilation, right? If I understand correctly. And then how much time does this cost?
Okay, yeah. So the time cost of compilation, right? So the first couple stages of this transformation cost no time at all, right? So converting it to Bayesian network, converting it to CNF, these are completely linear with respect to the size of the circuit. What does start to grow exponentially is this step, right? So this is the enumeration of the arithmetic circuit. Enumeration of the CNF, like counting through all the satisfying variable assignments to build this data structure. So this is where time cost starts to grow. And this is in practice, right? So if you do thousands and thousands of simulations, you pay this upfront cost of compiling this for, you know, sometimes like 15 minutes. You would crunch down that one circuit, take some time to do that compilation, and then reuse it as many times as needed. And usually that amortizes or recuperates the cost of doing this compilation.
Yeah, I guess I wanted to know, like, I guess roughly at which number, like, okay, after how many times you do the same circuit, do you actually gain with your method compared to actually, if I do it once, right, it's probably not.
Yeah, so these simulations, so this results trace here, this already incorporates to do the compilation, right? So for these sizes and for this depth, the compilation cost itself is less than 1 second still.
Okay, thank you. So is there any more questions?